I'd go to the moon in a nanosecond. The problem is we don't have the technology to do that anymore. We used to, but we destroyed that technology, and it's a painful process to build it back again.
I mean, Lindbergh flew across the Atlantic, I believe it was 1927. Now, to say it would be 50 years before anybody on Earth from any nation, including the one that did it 50 years earlier, it would be 50 years before another person flew across the Atlantic. That's just not the case. When Columbus sailed to the New World, it was like the following year. Everyone was sailing to the New World. When Lewis and Clark went west, it was the following year. Everyone went, you know, west. When the Wright brothers achieved powered flight, it was weeks later that other people around the world were achieving powered flight. To say that we could go to the moon on our first attempt with 1960s technology, and it cannot be repeated by any nation on Earth 50 years later?
Why has nobody been to the moon in such a long time?
That's not an 8-year-old's question. That's my question. I want to know, but I think I know. Because we didn't go there, and that's the way it happened.
If it were humanly possible to go to the moon in the 1960s, there would be bases there by now.
But look at everything that's discovered. First, perhaps it's used by the military or its technology, then it becomes commercialized. I cannot believe that after almost 50 years, we haven't commercialized trips to the moon. By now, we should have hotels. We should have cameras pointing to the Earth from the moon. And none of that has happened.
Well, look at Branson. All he was trying to do, he's a very smart guy, and he was just trying to achieve low Earth orbit, and he killed his crew. And NASA, the last two times they and the military tried to achieve Earth orbit outside of the space shuttle, they blew up. So if they can't go 200 miles above the Earth today, how could they land on another planet and play golf in the 1960s? It is completely illogical. The problem we have here, Mel, is this is the only crime, you could say, or conspiracy, whatever word you want to use, that is positive. I mean, whoever shot Kennedy, he's still dead. Whoever did 9/11, 3,000 people are still dead. But the moon landing is a positive lie. And it's like me telling you your favorite football team that just won the Super Bowl, well, they cheated. You know, they drugged the other team or they changed the score. You don't want to hear it. You're ready to punch me in the face for saying such a despicable thing. But what if it's true? The problem is people want to hear.
And you were punching the face a few times, right?
Well, that's true. The fact is, if I walked on the moon and someone else thought otherwise, I would find that hysterical. That would be like throwing a feather at me. Why would I be mad for someone throwing a feather at me? If someone said, well, you swear in a Bible that you walked on the moon, and I did, I'd say, sure, I swear in a stack of Bibles. You're okay? But the fact is, it would be like walking up to a man in front of his wife and saying, well, how's your girlfriend doing? That would make him mad because I'm revealing a truth that he wants suppressed.
So let's stay, I don't mean to interrupt you. Let's stay with the Van Allen belt for a moment because this is puzzling and it makes you wonder how dumb they think we are to not notice. And I've also seen interviews with NASA personnel where they're saying they're designing new spacesuits so that the astronauts can withstand going through the Van Allen belt. Anyone with a bit of brain, Bart, should question this. How is it that they're coming up with these spacesuits now when allegedly astronauts have been going through the Van Allen belt since 1969? I mean, take astronaut Alan Bean. You interviewed him, right? The fourth person to allegedly walk on the moon on November 69. He said he wasn't sure we went far enough out to encounter the Van Allen belt. Maybe we did. Then when you said the belt is 1,000 to 25,000 miles out, he said then we went through it.
The belts are 1,000 miles to 25,000 miles above the Earth.
We went right out through them.
No effects on yourselves?
We didn't even know it. I don't think anybody, well, maybe somebody said you went through the radiation belt, but we didn't feel it inside, and we didn't get any, you know, added radiation.
He basically said we hadn't discovered it then.
Yeah, he was kind of doing doublespeak. He wasn't even aware that he went through the Van Allen belts. I pointed out that the space shuttle can see the radiation from 640 miles away, and you're in the middle of it. You didn't have that effect? And he said, well, yeah, you know, after the fact. I said, but it wasn't reported at that time until 1994. And he said, yeah, but it hadn't been discovered. So he said he saw him, then he didn't see him. He said he went through the belt, but then he said he didn't. Can't really make up his mind. The guy also said, you know, during the alleged descent to the moon, it's super quiet. And he, you know, you can hear Neil Armstrong or whoever saying, you know, we're 100 feet away, 90 feet away, and it's dead quiet in the background. And he said, well, that's because the vacuum of space, which they use for a catch-all excuse for all the lies that are pointed out, that because of that, you can't hear the engine. But then again, Eugene Cernan, he says, oh, it's very loud while you're descending to the moon. Well, it's the same equipment.
We didn't have last-minute checks we could do. We only had one engine. It couldn't fail, so it ran at lower pressure. And when you were in it, you couldn't hear it in the vacuum of space.
So the engine is loud?
Pardon?
Is the engine loud as you're descending?
Well, the engine is very loud. It's very difficult to tell the difference between feeling sound and hearing sound, but yes, it's loud.
When you were in it, you couldn't hear it in the vacuum of space.
You would think that an astronaut would be well-versed on that if he's going to be going through it.
Yeah, but what can you do? You know, it's the thing that you have to really be a seeker of the truth. You have to be willing to be wrong. The Bible says that pride comes before a fall and that pride will blind you. Pride is simply the lack of willingness to be wrong. And humility, God says, I oppose the proud, but give grace to the humble, is your willingness to be wrong. I went to a church once, and they said, you know, how many people like to be wrong? And they were basically, no one raised their hand because they're very prideful about, we have an answer for every Bible question. They may not be the right answers, but they at least have one. And I said, well, I like to be wrong. And well, why? Well, number one, I'm not walking around self-deceived. And number two, I'm learning something new. You just have to be a truth seeker. It's amazing. Most people who adamantly believe that the moon landing is real will not entertain for 1/100th of a second that the moon missions were fake. They're like gaga over it. They worship it. In fact, during the launch, you can hear people say, my God. Well, that's it exactly. The overflowing of the heart, the mouth speaks. It is their God. They are brainwashed by Star Trek, which preceded it by a couple of years, that, you know, traveling around the world and all the universe is, you know, as easy as microwaving a burrito. And so surely we can walk on the moon if they can do that. It was, you know, who knows if that was predictive programming or what. It's so simple. If they can go to the moon with 1960s technology, and I can buy a watch from Walmart for $10 that has 100 times the computing power as that rocket, then they could go today, but they cannot do it. That is so crystal clear that they didn't go.
Right now, we only can fly in Earth orbit. That's the farthest that we can go. And this new system that we're building is going to allow us to go beyond and hopefully take humans into the solar system to explore. So the moon, Mars, asteroids, there's a lot of destinations that we could go to, and we're building these building block components in order to allow us to do that eventually.
In fact, 4 out of 5 people who watch A Funny Thing Happen on the Way to the Moon reverse their opinion as to the authenticity of the moon missions, largely because of this newly discovered unedited footage of outtakes from the mission of them faking a shot right in front of your eyes. It's not a theory that we didn't go to the moon. It is prior to this footage being uncovered. It's a fact. You can see it and hear it with your own eyes and ears.
But even today, before we started, I was talking to my wife, and she's not into any of these topics. She believes that we went to the moon. She thinks, well, that's okay. But I said, all right, so you believe we went to the moon. It's been 50 years almost, and we haven't commercialized it. And she actually paused and said, that's the most compelling thing I've ever heard. You may be onto something, she said. But if space is a vacuum, Bart, what in the world are spacecraft pushing against? Don't we need air or water or something to push against in order to maneuver in space?
Well, not necessarily. You could, what they allegedly have around this Apollo spacecraft, and they have it around satellites too, are these tiny little rockets that correct the inertia slightly, one direction or the other. You don't need it. In fact, it technically would be more more viable and more accurate to not have the resistance of air.
But what are they pushing against? You need to
Nothing. They're not pushing against anything. They just have to have escape velocity, and then once they're on a trajectory, it just needs to be altered slightly. It can go to the left, right, up, down, or whatever. It can also be slowed down or sped up. Theoretically, you could go to the moon if you had enough protection from the radiation, but we're talking at least a foot of lead around the entire spacecraft. And then, according to von Braun, once you landed on the moon, in his original writings, you would have to immediately go into a cave in the moon, if you could find one, to protect yourself from micrometeorites. Meteorites, I don't know how many hit the Earth every day, but I'm sure it's in the tens of thousands of falling stars, little sparks in the sky. They burn up before they hit the Earth because of the atmosphere and the friction thereof. However, on the moon, you don't have atmosphere, so all those tens of thousands of meteorites are hitting the moon every single day. And if you have a meteorite only the size of a grain of sand, that thing is traveling anywhere from 15,000 to 25,000 miles per hour. And it's going to go through your brain and through your space suit or spacecraft and cause decompression. And it's going to kill you. In fact, von Braun said there would be a 50% chance of a catastrophic failure because of a micrometeorite on the moon every 48 hours. And then he completely recanted on that. In fact, he said to reach the moon initially, you would need three rockets, not one, and each rocket would have to be about 40 times bigger than the Apollo spacecraft. In fact, he recanted on his math by a factor of more than 30,000%. When Kennedy set the goal to go to the moon. Now, number one, how can you trust a guy who is that far off on his math? Or it seems like he's making some sort of political correctness change here. I mean, after all, Kennedy was not a scientist. He was a visionary politician. We went up into space for 15 minutes, went from the East Coast to the West Coast, didn't even orbit the whole Earth. 3 days later, the guy says, hey, let's make a goal to go to the moon before the end of the 1960s, December 31st, 1969. We allegedly met that goal within 5%. What happened was, is it proved to be an impossibility. He was killed. Johnson took over. Of course, he's from Texas, and all that NASA money is in Houston. Mm-hmm. And out of all the presidents who were eligible to run for re-election as an incumbent in the entire history of the country, there was only two who chose not to, one of which is Johnson, because he knew they were going to fake the moon landing. Now, who knew that would work? It might work. It might not work. And if it didn't work, and you got caught when you were president, what a legacy that would be. It would be worse than Nixon. And so he chose not to run so he would not have to deal with that hot potato. Then Nixon comes in, tricky dick, and you have to understand there's no independent press coverage. People say, well, there are 100,000 people involved in NASA. That's true. But there are 150,000 people involved in building the atomic bomb in 1944. And yet, they didn't know what they were building. One person built the switch, another person built this, that, and the other. It's completely departmentalized to keep it a secret. You really think they're going to tell the guy building the glove or the door of the boot, hey, the moon landings are fake, but don't tell anybody. Give me a break. The thing is like a pyramid, and only the people at the very top know what is going on. They go up, and then there's only three eyewitnesses, three. I mean, people say, oh, well, you deny the Holocaust. Of course not. World War II was done on Earth in front of a billion eyewitnesses. But each moon landing only had three eyewitnesses controlled by the government, and there's no independent press coverage, right? There's all sorts of independent press coverage of World War II, but who can go to the moon? Who can go to outer space? We just assumed, because we trusted Nixon, that these pictures, television, were coming from the moon, but they're just coming from the government. They can say whatever they want to say. You know, the idea that this alleged new lunar, orbiter taking a picture of the surface and have these little shadows or scratches, it's amazing that people think this is proof that the moon landings are fake. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. Nearly 50 years ago, they faked a full body picture standing on the moon's surface of an astronaut. So you don't think they can fake little scratches or shadows on a lunar satellite picture 50 years later with Photoshop? I mean, come on. It's like asking a criminal to provide his own proof of his own guilt. Do you really think he's going to do that? I mean, it's absurd. It says, well, go to NASA.gov and you can see all the proof of the moon landings being real. Really?
What about the Clementine mission? Why haven't we seen more? Only 10% of the images we've seen.
Well, one interesting thing is that NASA now says that all of the lunar landing sites are off limits, that you cannot go there. You physically
right.
can't send a rover there or whatever. Well, that's pretty convenient, isn't it? You know, you cannot, you know, according to China, they are banned from sending a rover to the Apollo 11 landing site, which could theoretically, you know, prove that there's nothing there, because there is nothing there. And China, unfortunately, is kind of in bed with the United States. They're not going to call our BS, and we're not going to call theirs. I mean, they have most favored nation training status, even though they run over their own citizens with tanks mm-hmm. when they want to have a democracy. I mean, is that a little contradictory or what? So they know. In fact, they teach in college, high school, and elementary school in China that the moon landings are fake. They never say it publicly. That's just what they do in their own country. I've talked to Russians, and they say the only people who think the moon landings are real are the brainwashed Americans because of the propaganda they're constantly fed. Every year, History Channel comes up, you know, with Apollo moon missions are great. Well, here's something. The Saturn V rocket, all the schematics and engineering and blueprints, as well as the lunar module, they say, well, none of that's classified. They're just not available. We destroyed them.
It was all recorded on these telemetry tapes. So where is this hard evidence?
I haven't seen anything that indicates the telemetry data is even in existence. And as I said, even if we had it, we don't have the machines to play it back.
But your own research has shown the telemetry data is missing.
That's right.
Could this be true, mankind's first interplanetary exploration, and the original science data is missing? If it's anywhere, it should be here, at NASA's Goddard Space Center in Maryland.
Doesn't have it either. The Smithsonian
right.
doesn't have it.
Right.
Johnson doesn't
right.
have it.
Right. We've been unable to track it down. I mean, we don't know where this telemetry data ended up. And we don't know what path it may have taken. So, unfortunately, I'm afraid I can't really give you much of a clue as to where this data ended up and whether it still exists or not.
Now, if you had made this great invention of something that flawlessly lands on the moon on the first attempt and comes back and can somehow, with a bank of car batteries, compete with air conditioning against 250 degrees outside for 3 days nonstop, I think I would want to save, you know, the millions and billions of dollars worth of engineering designs and schematics on that. But they were deliberately destroyed so that you could not later prove that it's simply impossible to power air conditioning against 250 degrees on this bank of car batteries for more than, you know, probably an hour. And then it would probably only get down to about 190 degrees. So all this stuff you could prove. You could prove the Saturn V didn't have enough fuel to have escape velocity, but they destroyed all the, you know, original diagrams of it. And of course, you know, they also destroyed all the original, every single original TV image of every moon mission got accidentally lost. Now, they have a copy, or the original, of the Constitution, and which is 237 years old, the Declaration of Independence and all these things, but they can't keep videotapes of the most important event in the country's history. They lose them. I've estimated that this is about 1 to 2 tons worth of videotapes, and they lost it. And then the only VCR that can play back these one-of-a-kind formatted tapes, they deliberately disassembled and destroyed the parts so that if the tapes are found in the future, you can't ever watch them anyway. In fact, poor Ron Howard, who was so gaga over Apollo, even though his own grandfather told him that the moon missions were fake and he ignored him, he had this IMAX 70mm, you know, extravaganza 10, 20 years ago about the moon landings and all they're great. Watch the movie. 90% of it are reenactments because there's so little original footage from the missions. And then some of them, of this huge IMAX screen, is this little box about 10% inside, and you can see a VHS tracking line. You know why? Because the footage was so hard to come by, he rented it from Blockbuster just like I did. I can see the VHS tracking line. And it's because of him that the tapes got lost anyway, because he called up NASA, and he said, you know, what we've got is fourth generation, a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy. And I want the originals, and I want to do all digital transfers, and I want it to be seen in the highest detail possible. They said, I'll get back with you. And when they got back with him, all the tapes were lost. Thank you, Ron Howard.
Now stay there for a moment because this is something that puzzles me too, the disappearance of all these the tapes, but also 1939, we were finally able to watch movies in Technicolor. Yet 30 years later, all we could get were second generation black and white images of the most important achievement for humanity, where a camera is just filming a monitor.
Yeah, what they did was they had a camera that was allegedly on the moon. Then the networks complained that they couldn't take a live feed. Why you wouldn't want the public to see the highest resolution, you know, just dumbfounds me, unless, of course, it's fake and you don't want them to see the, you know, the details of the studio, which is why they did it. Right. Then that would go to a TV monitor at NASA. That would be filmed by a video camera. That would be projected, if you can imagine projection TV quality, on a big, you know, probably 4 by 6 foot screen at NASA. And then that would be filmed by a TV camera. They were deliberately lowering and lowering and lowering the resolution of the picture so that you couldn't see the fake backdrop and things like that. I mean, after all, the very important TV show Gilligan's Island went from black and white to color, I think, in 1967. So I would think NASA might have a little bit more budget than Gilligan's Island if they could afford, you know, and I Dream a Genie and that's Bewitched, right, went from, you know, black and white
Batman
to color in about 1960s. That's right. Surely NASA, with all the money in the world and the best technology on the planet, could have a super high resolution color image coming from the moon. But they didn't want to do that. In fact, the second mission to the moon, Apollo 12, they accidentally, in quotes, pointed the camera at the sun a minute and a half into the mission, and it had no TV pictures of the mission after that. Apollo 13, allegedly, you know, this, you know, calamity, it was simply because reruns of I Love Lucy were being interrupted. You know, on the second time to the moon, people were complaining. They'd already seen us go to the moon once. Why are you interrupting I Love Lucy? So they added this life and death jeopardy thing. They never left Earth orbit either.
So people were desensitized to that point?
Absolutely. I mean, imagine, let's say right now, they're putting a flag or reaching the South Pole for the very first time. You and I would put it on the screen here. We'd take a moment. We would watch it. Now, 6 months from now, they do it a second time. Do we really care?
And they're interrupting the Kardashians. The Kardashians people would get mad, right?
That's right. So, yeah, you know, you watch it the first time, but the second time, well, you know, whatever. But they were milking it. It was a cash cow. And so the whole thing about Apollo 13 was simply to add drama and intrigue to the moon missions to hopefully get people to watch them, because every time they went to the moon, they pocketed billions and billions of dollars. Where do you think these black budgets come from? You know, people knew during the Vietnam War they were in Cambodia, they were in Laos, even though Congress said, no, you cannot do that, because they were taking money from projects like this and siphoning it off to buy secret military equipment to do things that Congress did not authorize. That was going on then, and it's going on now.
Well, let me ask you this, Bart. You're a photographer, a filmmaker. You remember when we used to carry rolls of film through security at the airport, and we were always concerned about losing our images when going through the X-ray machine. If the moon had no has no atmosphere and no protection from radiation, how are the astronauts able to take a single photograph? Were the Hasselblad cameras protected with gold layers?
No, they weren't. In fact, if you see, you can also see this at my YouTube channel, linked through Sobrel.com. You can see the Fox special. The Fox special is, in my opinion, one of the top films. I worked on it. It's called Conspiracy Theory, Did We Land on the Moon? That's on my YouTube channel as well. I was one of the contributors, and they interviewed me about it. The most compelling part of that TV special are two things. Myself, when I say, as the alleged expert on the topic, I would bet my life that we did not go to the moon. And the second most compelling to me as a viewer of it is when the designer of the camera sits there and looks at the pictures and says, these pictures look like they were lit in a television studio. I don't know why they look that way. And he looks down at his hands, very embarrassed. There were micrometeorites. There was a temperature discrepancy of 500 degrees between the sunlight and the shadow. The shadow was about minus 250 Fahrenheit, and the sun was about plus 250. Then there's space radiation, and there's no fogging from the temperature changes going hot, cold, hot, cold, hot, cold all the time, from shade to from shade to sunlight, back and forth. There's no radiation damage. There's no streaking, like the radiation the astronauts saw in the space shuttle getting near the Van Allen radiation belt, like little sparks going through there. None of that is there. Pretty amazing. What's also amazing is I personally went to the archives, and I said, can you please show me a picture of Neil Armstrong standing on the moon during Apollo 11? They went through every single picture, and there wasn't a single one. Now, wait a minute. Isn't this the greatest event in human history, and isn't he the first man to walk on the moon? And there's actually not a picture of him by himself standing on the surface of the moon, aside from an automatic motion picture camera on the side of the lunar module. Now, the excuse is, well, he's taking all the pictures, and that's why he's not in them. Well, if that were me, and I was spending billions and billions of dollars to go to the moon for the first time.
Get two cameras at least, one for me, one for you.
Yeah, I might want to have a backup camera. You could drop the thing, and then you have no pictures of this great event. But the thing is, he did not want his picture taken.
Why is that?
That's the same reason he doesn't give interviews, because he does not want liability. He does not want to fake it. He did it very reluctantly, likely because of threats against his wife and family. And he's cooperating to the absolute minimum because it disgusts him that he had to do this. Now, later on in life, he started, unfortunately, his character changed, I believe, for the worse. And he started milking it. I mean, there's a company, I visited him in New York City, and I forget the name of the company, but some company that builds smart bombs that, collateral damage is about 99% of the people, and they get, the one that they wanted to get. And he's CEO, kind of a token CEO of that company. I mean, hey, Neil Armstrong's the, on the board or chairman of the board of our company. You should invest in it, right? And so the guy was unfortunately cashing in on his notoriety, even though he did not actually do what he claimed to have done. And you could see, I think it was 1994 or 96, one of the anniversaries, 25th anniversary or something like that, of the moon landing. I think it was 1994, 25th anniversary. And you could see at the end of my film, a funny thing happened on the way to the moon, him leave this little cryptic remark. He had been invited to the White House with the other two crew members of Apollo 11, and there were some high school students who were touring the White House at that time and paused to be part of the audience. And he said to them with tears in his eyes, and it was the only part of his speech he had completely memorized and looked straight ahead, and he said, perhaps someday you will be able to remove one of truth's
protective layers. I know it by heart, yeah.
To you, we say, we have only completed a beginning. We leave you much that is undone. There are great ideas undiscovered. Breakthroughs available to those who can remove one of truth's protective layers. There are places to go beyond belief. Those challenges are yours. In many fields, not the least of which is space, because there lies human destiny.
Now, you saw humanity in his eyes at that point. But years later, when I met him on two or more occasions and saw him in a couple of other, anniversary remarks, he looked like he lost his soul. He didn't care anymore. He had totally committed to the deceit, and that's too bad.
When you met him, and I've watched that video many times, and the other astronauts, and we have to take a break and discuss all of this when we come back. But when you met Neil Armstrong, what was your reaction when you questioned him?
Well, he was very nervous. He started shaking like a leaf. And I offered him $5,000 cash, which is $1,000 a second, just to put his hand on the Bible, raise his right hand, and say, I swear to God, I walked on the moon. He refused to do it. He got very, very nervous.
Mr. Seibel, you do not deserve answers.
Very few astronauts were willing to do that, and the few that did regretted it, because it's an oath that could be used as a deposition in court.
Absolutely. We have to take a one and only intermission. When we come back, I want to discuss the Masonic connection. Also, the first press conference, every time I watch that video, and you probably do too, when you watch that video of the three astronauts there having their faces almost as if their parents have been killed a minute before that. Why? When this should be the happiest moment for humankind in a way.
But rather one that took place in the last decade. We all here and the people listening in today had the opportunity to share that adventure over its developing and unfolding in the past months and years. It's our privilege today to share with you some of the details of that final month of July that was certainly the highlight for the three of us of that decade. We're going to divert a little bit from the format of past press conferences and talk about the things that interested us most, in particular the things that occurred on and about the moon. We will use a number of films and slides which most of you have already seen, and with the intent of pointing out some of the things that we observed on the spot, which may not be obvious to those of you who are looking at them here from the surface of Earth. The flight, as you know, started promptly. And I think that was characteristic of all the events of the flight. The Saturn gave us one magnificent ride. Both into Earth orbit and on a trajectory to the moon. Our memory of that actually differs little from the reports that you have all heard from those previous Saturn V flights, and those the previous flights served us well in preparation for this flight in the boost as well as the subsequent phases. We would like to skip directly to the translunar coast phase and remind ourselves of the chain of events, that long chain of events that actually permitted a landing, starting with the undockings, the transposition and dockings.